afternoon, everybody. And I'll be talking about the various problems where we see ankle equinus and how are they managed and how does the gait affect these children. So if you look at this slide closely, there are nearly four children walking on toes. And each of this child here, if you see, they have a different pattern of walking on toes and how this toe walking is affecting the joints proximally, as well as the patterns are also different. So same way, the management also changes for each of this child, considering depending on what the age of the child is. And every age group will have different type of procedures maybe which may be required. Also, the second thing which affects largely is the etiology. So a syndromic child or a congenital talipes equinus or an idiopathic toe walker or a CP may not all be treated in the same manner. And this is a quick list of some of the patients or etiologies where we see toe walking very commonly. And most of the time, not being worked up, they are just labeled as CP. And that's a very bad thing, because taking away that label is a very difficult thing when somebody writes on the paper just because the child is walking on toes. And these are the long list of different things which should be ruled out before we plan for any surgery, and establishing a diagnosis is must. The surgeries is quite same, but yes, why they differ? Because we have to plan for a procedure, a pre-op preparation in terms of anesthesia and a pre-op rehab is important. Particularly for kids with myopathy or other disorders, we need special anesthetic preparations. Also, post-op protocols will differ for each of the etiology. And yes, prognosis, explaining what is going to happen later to the parents is again an important task. And hence, getting a diagnosis is very important. So now I'll take you through a couple of cases and we see how each of this toe walker has gone through the surgery for the equinus correction and how has it affected the gait. So first thing is, let's look at this child. This is a 1.5-year-old child, and the concerns are that since the child started standing with support or cruising, the child has been on toes. Now when we look at this child, it seems like probably there's a fixed equinus contracture, but on evaluating, it is just a spasticity. And this could come because of various reasons, either a CP, a HSP, or there could be syndromes which mimic CP. And hence a good workup is very important. Either of this, it would be treated with a simple botulinum toxin injection, which is done in the muscle belly here as shown. It can be done either by a freehand technique, or to be more precise and have a real-time visualization of the injection by performing it with an ultrasound-guided approach. How does this affect the toe walking? So post the Botox injection and a plaster, the child's spasticity in the gastro just goes away. And if you see, it has been a very good early intervention. The child has become independent. The child has learned to walk without support. We have prevented a contracture. Of course, it has caused functional improvement. And getting the foot down as flat, it prevents further midfoot break. So in a younger child, this is what we are actually aiming for and looking out for the outcome post our intervention. Now, second is, when is it like we first had a doubt whether that was a contracture? Now, this is a case where, yes, it is a fixed contracture. And how do we see that? Again, by checking on the evaluation that this is a fixed contracture with knee straight and with knee bend, what we call the Silver-Sciol test, the ankle doesn't move at all. And this is a fixed ankle contracture in a child with hemiplegia. Of course, this is a child with cerebral palsy. And here we see that what different procedures can be performed. So initially the calf zones was divided into 5, and the newer terminologies we use is dividing them into 3. So here the 1 and 3 have kind of exchanged places. What is important is the zone 2. And all surgeries should be performed in the zone 2 level, because any surgeries distal to it are going to cause weakness, iatrogenic crouch, difficulty in push-off, and also having a weakness of the gastrosoleus and affecting the gait cycle. So this is one of the most important things. What traditionally TAT not means were done should be totally avoided. And what we now encourage is doing more of Vulpius, Strayers, or a Baker's procedure in zone 2, and a posteromedial approach just to do a gastrosoleus recession is performed. It can either be done as an open procedure or as an ultrasound guided procedure again. So this is the part which is post lengthening you see here, and that requires a little much more expertise. So this is the same child, and you see that post it the heel contact is good. Sorry. So the child gets a very good heel to toe pattern of gait. The knee doesn't get affected. If this child continues to walk on toes like this, eventually the knee, hip and the pelvis is going to get affected. So we prevent that by performing this simple surgeries. Now after seeing a true equinus, there are cases where we often see an apparent equinus. So true equinus is the one where the tibia and the ankle always make an angle which is in plantar flexion. While you look at this child, there is an equinus, but when you look at it from the side, you will see that the tibia and the foot, they are either neutral or in dorsiflexion. And here, this is not a candidate to be treated for equinus. If we treat here as any sort of TAT not means or gastrosoleus recession, the child is going to just sink down more, go in a more worst crouch, and maybe probably become a non-walker. So totally never to touch the gastrocs in an apparent equinus. And here only the surgery should be aimed at treating the hamstring contractures itself, which is causing the apparent equinus here. Now coming to habitual equinus. After all this looking like equinus, a true equinus and an apparent equinus, we have kids who walk out of fun in their younger age group on toes because they enjoy doing that. They mimic their parents, or they love doing that out of fun for getting attention. Most of these children have hyperactivity disorders or autism disorders, and they walk on toes. And when parents tell them to get the heel down, they of course do that. So idiopathic toe walking or habitual toe walking is a diagnosis of exclusion. Once we have ruled out all the other options, the MRI brain is normal, the imaging is normal, and all the syndromes and everything what the list I shown before is all ruled out, then this diagnosis has to be made. We can see them in younger children as well as older children. The key here is that the CP kid will not walk with knees straight at this age. The knees would have already gone in crouch here. So the key is to always look beyond CP and see that it is not just neuromuscular, but there are other problems. And yes, these toe walkers, initially they can be treated with splints, stretching, and at a younger age group, occupational therapy and physio helps. Once this sets in and there is a contracture, then of course the gastrosoleus recession is the only way out. How we differentiate or how we plan is by doing an additional 3D gait analysis, getting the muscle tendon lens on an software which is connected with the gait lab, which also helps us to understand whether these lengthenings are to be done or not, and accordingly a surgery can be planned. Very simple ones are congenital equinus, or those kids where partly the CTEVs are treated with massage and they just walk on toes, and they at times look like this. However, this child, after a complete workup, was a syndromic child, and after the karyotyping and the chromosomal assay and the axonal sequence, the child had Char syndrome. And no matter what I said, these things are important to do the prognosis and to know if this toe walking is going to recur. Are there going to be other deformities? Because parents always have this question, will this come back? Do we need to do therapy lifelong? Does my child need to wear the splints for a longer duration post-surgeries? And establishing a diagnosis or getting the right getting the diagnosis in this place helps us to answer all this question. Now in this case, this is a proper candidate to go for a distal TAT not me like we would do in a CTEV, which is just 1 or 1.5 centimeter above the posterior crease. It works well post a 3 weeks plaster. And again, like the first child we saw, kids become independent, they get a good flat feet contact, and they start walking wonderfully. Coming to the next case, now if all these equinus, they are not being treated on time and if they get neglected, what happens? So look at this child. On the right side you see the equinus is quite pronounced, and when he steps on the left side, there is a midfoot break and you see that he tries to put the foot down. So he has already gone into a plano-valgoid feet as he grows. So kids, as they grow and they gain weight and they continue to walk on pressure with on the metatarsal joints, they get a midfoot break, which eventually causes...
Chasna, would you please conclude?
So there are just two more slides and we are done. So which eventually causes talonavicular uncoverage and extension... and leads to external tibial torsion. So continuing to walk in this position causes a lot of external tibial torsion. So most of these cases, these are most of the problems, and they can be treated accordingly. For the lateral short column, we need to do a lengthening of the calcaneum or any other osteotomies in the cuneiform or cuboid. And for treating the torsion, we need to do a supramalleolar tibial osteotomy. So this is a child who was walking with a plano-valgoid feet for a long time, and now we see that he has developed torsional problem. Just treating the foot here is not going to help, and this needs an additional derotation osteotomy at the level of tibia, at the supramalleolar level, and a gastrosoleus recession, of course. And all this, this surgery would correct the following problems in the gait eventually. So coming to the last...
Chasnal, I think we'll take questions.
Actually the cases we are going to continue in this. So I'll finish this, the case part.
Yeah, because we have now only 5 minutes before we can go for papers.
Yes. Okay, so coming to the last part is equinus in a non-spastic child, where the child has myopathy. And if you look at this child, after ruling out all the diagnosis, the equinus, just correcting the gastrosoleus recession, doing a gastrosoleus recession or correcting equinus is not going to help. And we need to power the antagonist and help get a good dorsiflexion. And hence a tibialis anterior transfer along with the gastrosoleus recession was performed for this child. And so all these surgeries usually improve a good heel strike. They improve the ankle rockers. They help in a very good push-off, clearance. They give adequate step length. They maintain the good speed of the child and generation of ground reaction forces, and the child walks with less energy consumption. So to conclude, I would say that, and of course, yes, we do not plan surgeries for kids with dystrophy. And just to say that we need to always look above and beyond the foot. So this child was referred to me for walking on toes for Botox, and on doing a PBH X-ray, the child had a neglected DDH, which was neglected till age 4. So we always need to see one or two joints above as well if there are any other problems. And to conclude, I would say that, again, it is important to establish a diagnosis. And the decision to perform the surgery at what age and what procedure is also important. TA tenotomy should be totally avoided in neuromuscular condition. And we should always have a prognosis in hand to explain to the parents beforehand. Thank you.